So David Orell has got one of the books that's going to be on sale upstairs called Economyths. But just before I talk about that, you're a Canadian.
Yes.
You're a mathematician. You like complex systems like weather and genetics and the economy. Mm-hmm. And the book is all about that. But the bit that I like best is the subtitle, which very broadly goes along the lines of 10 things that economists get wrong. So David, over to you, and you're very
welcome. Thank you very much, yeah. Yeah, we actually changed the subtitle for the new version because in order to make it more friendly to economists, but I don't know if it worked or not. So I think in order to get to break through to some new kind of capitalism, we also, part of that is to change the way that we do economics. Economics is can be viewed as a sort of mathematical model of the world, and I think mathematical models are interesting because they encode a kind of a story, and they tell us a lot about the way we see the world and we see ourselves. A good example of this was one of the older mathematical models, the Greek model of the cosmos, and this was really based on two main assumptions. The first was that everything moves in circles because these were considered the most perfect of forms, and the other was that everything moved around the Earth. And in the Aristotelian scheme, the planets and so on are actually believed to be encased in crystalline spheres which moved at different speeds around us. So both of these assumptions were clearly wrong, but nonetheless, the model managed to persist for well over 1,000 years. So it's interesting to ask why, and I think there's a number of reasons. One is that, as Aristotle said, man is a political animal. And for the Greeks, there was considered to be a parallel between what was going on in the cosmos and what was going on in human society. So if you had a model which argued that, the universe was ordered and stable and rational, then that was obviously supported the status quo, in this case, the few hundred male citizens who ruled ancient Athens. But I think perhaps a more important reason is that this model, could make accurate predictions. It could predict things like eclipses to a very high degree of accuracy, which was really quite a strong demonstration of its power. And so, as I said, the model lasted for well over 1,000 years, and it wasn't really until the Renaissance when Copernicus came along and argued that the Earth went around the Sun rather than vice versa. And then the Danish astronomer Tycho Brahe, he actually observed a comet which passed in between the planets. And so if these crystalline spheres had actually existed, then it would have broken through them. So, and then Isaac Newton came along with this law of gravity and so on. And Newton believed that matter was made up of these solid, massy, hard particles, i.e. atoms. And so his work kind of laid out a template which science has continued to follow to the present day, which is basically break a system down into its constituent parts, figure out the mathematical equations, and solve. And this has been very successful in all sorts of areas, especially chemistry and physics and things like this. And it was also adopted with gusto by economists in the late 19th century when they formed neoclassical economics, which was directly inspired by Newton's rational mechanics. I like this equation, quote from Newton: "I can calculate the motions of heavenly bodies, but not the madness of people." But nonetheless, economists being eternal optimists, they decided to forge ahead anyway. But in order to do this, to make a mathematical model of the economy, they had to make a lot of assumptions. And these assumptions, no one actually thinks they're completely true, but they've been amazingly influential. So for example, the theory assumed that individuals and firms are like the atom of the economy here. They act independently and rationally to maximize their own utility. Then the invisible hand drives the economy to a stable equilibrium, and the result of all this was supposed to be a sort of maximal societal happiness. And this led to the famous caricature of rational economic man. And these assumptions were used to build models of the economy. And as with the Greek models of the cosmos, the aim was to be able to predict the future. But in this case, didn't work quite as well. So, predictions of something like gross domestic product here, the solid line is the data and the light line are the forecasts, which don't really line up very well. And actually, economic forecasts over these longer time periods are basically no better than random guessing. And in the 1960s, the efficient market hypothesis was floated as an explanation for this. And this was a physics-inspired theory which assumes that markets kind of magically achieve this optimal equilibrium. Any changes are basically random perturbations to this, which inherently cannot be predicted. But you should still be able to calculate the risk based on some, you know, statistical things like the normal distribution or bell curve. And this was used to create all of these techniques such as Black-Scholes, Gaussian copula value at risk, which played rather a large role in the recent financial crisis. So, you know, so what's going on here? Why is it that we still seem to be, you know, these storms continue to take us by surprise? We can't make accurate predictions even of the probability of these events. Well, just to look at some of the assumptions in a bit more detail. So the theory assumes that the invisible hand drives the, you know, the economy to a stable equilibrium. But if you look at something like the price of gold, okay, it was sort of stable when it was controlled by the government, but since then it's been sort of showing all this sort of boom-bust behavior. And the reason for this is that the reason that you buy an asset like gold is because you want it to go up in value. So when it is going up in value, we get excited and we buy more, and this positive feedback drives it up further, and then the same thing in reverse on the way down. And that's why you get this characteristic boom-bust behavior, which you also see in other things like oil. Oil is often called the lifeblood of the economy, but back in 2008, it looked like we were having a cardiac event. The dashed lines here again are the forecast from the Department of Energy. So this kind of unpredictability is consistent with efficiency, I guess, but it, of course it doesn't prove it, because just because something is unpredictable doesn't mean it's efficient. Snowstorms are very unpredictable, but no one thinks they're efficient. But the theory also makes these other assumptions, such as that, you know, price variations are small, random, independent, and so on. But as we know, large changes frequently occur, far more frequently than should be expected, as in September 2008, when it was nearly lights out for the economy. And the reason for this is that the statistical model is completely, it's not normal, basically. The statistics of markets are actually exactly like the statistics of earthquakes. So basically, most price changes are small, just like the Earth is constantly feeling small tremors, but there's the ever-present possibility of an extreme event. The theory assumes that people act independently and make rational decisions. The proof of market equilibrium actually assumed infinite computational capacity, rational expectations theory, and so on and so forth. And it's sort of like we're modeling ourselves as if we're as omnipotent as the all-seeing eye which adorns the back of every US dollar bill. But the truth, you know, as we know, is more like this, right? We're affected by all sorts of emotions, especially during times of market turmoil. And finally, this idea, you know, neoclassical, the whole idea was to optimize happiness, right? That's what it was all about at the beginning. It wasn't about optimizing money, it was to make people happy. But if you actually look at, you know, the gross domestic product, the economy has grown a lot in recent decades, but happiness levels have been sort of static or even slightly falling. And there's a couple of reasons. I mean, one is that, like the couple in the cartoon, by Bourne Van Loon, is that there's a sort of a saturation effect. I mean, once you make a certain amount of money, it doesn't really help to get much more. But another reason, I think, is that we've sort of internalized these values of, you know, rationality, independence, optimizing our utility all the time. And if, you know, any psychologist or, you know, sort of most people will be able to tell you that things which make you happy have got much more to do with things like connectivity, connection with other people, communicating. And so, you know, it's almost like this theory of ours could be making us unhappy. So just to stand back and look at this, so our orthodox theory is based on these ideas of stability, symmetry, order, and logic, which go back to the ancient Greeks. We model people as if they were rational. We model the economy as if it obeyed the harmony of the spheres, but it's far more wild than that. I mean, we are far more wild than that. So I think we're doing exactly the same thing that the Greeks were doing. We're imposing our ideas of rationality and order and logic onto the universe. But there's one important difference, which is that the Greek models could at least predict when the lights were going to go out, right? You know, we can't do that. Our models don't have that predictive validity to them, that empirical validity. Okay, so how are we going to break through the metaphorical crystalline spheres here and kind of get through to a new approach? Do we need another Tycho Brahe or a Newton? Well, I think there's lots of ideas coming in from other areas. I'm just going to kind of go through these very quickly, if I may. It's basically a shift from seeing the world as a machine to seeing it as a living organism. So some of these things, complex organic systems, which I include the economy, are characterized by emergent properties, so they resist the reductionist approach, the Newtonian approach. They operate at a state that's far from equilibrium rather than stable. They exhibit power law statistics like earthquakes as opposed to normal statistics. They show they're based on network dynamics as opposed to atomistic individualistic dynamics. There are these opposing positive and negative feedback loops which create an inherent internal tension. And it's this which results in uncertainty and difficulty. This is why we can't predict the future. It has nothing to do with efficiency. So new mathematical techniques have been developed to sort of work with these systems, things like network theory, nonlinear dynamics, agent-based models. We've got insights coming in from other areas. I think we're going to be talking about systems thinking later on. And there's a general shift from the idea of deterministic prediction to robustness, questions of robustness and stability. I mean, after all, if we can't predict the financial crisis, what are we going to do with an environmental crisis? Okay, so just to sum up, so like the classical model of the cosmos, the orthodox model of the economy pictures the world as rational, stable, ordered, and efficient. Why has it persisted for so long? Well, I think in this case it doesn't have anything to do with prediction, so that just leaves basically politics and the status quo. Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you.